Next lecture is by Mieke Vosse from Scala Architecten, coming from the Netherlands, who is working mainly in urban renewal, in new architectural projects, also integrated in their context.
Good morning. Thank you for this invitation. And I think we have seen that Intbau is really getting an international network, because we were in Africa and Belgium, and now we go to the Netherlands. The work of my office, Scala Architecten, has from the beginning had very strong connections with inhabitants. We supported neighborhood actions against demolition by making alternative designs. We made plans for urban renewal with preservation of existing buildings. Those buildings were sometimes real monuments with an official and legal status. But there were also buildings that people just were used to have them in their neighborhood, like familiar faces that you don't want to lose. So there are, from this approach, there are two consequences that relate to the theme of this symposium: placemaking and traditional architecture. First, although trained as modern architects, we had to know more about existing buildings. So we kind of were self-educated in buildings. And since a lot of these buildings were monumental, it was a self-education in a traditional building. Second is, we started from the power that inhabitants develop. I think we can never underestimate the power of the users of buildings and urban space. I want to reflect a little bit on that, because at a certain point, every man or woman wants to have a place of their own. A home, a base, the place from which you approach life. This desire has the power to result in a house. And cities and villages are made of houses where people like to live. No people, no neighborhood, no village, no city. It's very simple, but every architect should be very aware of this notion. Now, in preparing this lecture, I discovered that some of the essential concepts that we are used to working are not easily translated. So I have to teach you some Dutch. We have this word wonen, which in English is translated as to live, usually. And if you, als je ergens woont, je woont in a woning. Woning, which means house. And you are the bewoner, you are the guy that lives in the house, the girl that lives in the house. So the bewoner woont in a woning, and there he has his living room, which is called the woonkamer. And you have the space surrounding your house, it's your woonomgeving. So this is a very strong notion. Ik woon in a woning, ik heb mijn woonomgeving. And if you translate, you see how it kind of disappears, because you are a resident or an inhabitant of a house, and you have a living room. So somehow I think woonomgeving is the public space that belongs to a house. Now, these people are not just sitting on the street. They are not just sitting in front of their house. They are in their own woonomgeving. They are sitting, in this case, on a stoep, which is translated as doorstep or sidewalk. But listen, they own this. These are houses, they were for sale, and they didn't only buy the house, they also buy 1.20 meters in front of the house. So these little fences, these fence-shaped fences, are intended to reduce the traffic too close to the windows. So woonomgeving is somehow the public space that belongs to your house. The facades of your house are the walls of this woonomgeving, of this surroundings. Now, here you see, these are rental houses. The same goes for rental houses. People who live here don't own their house, and they don't own and they rent it, but they have the same area. Now, somehow, this use of the space around your house as part of your house is custom in the Netherlands. So this woman is reading her newspaper. She may have left her front door open. I think you see the door on the right of the image. She's home. She's not outside on the street. She's home reading her newspaper. So she's home in the inner city of Amsterdam, but it also goes for extension areas with only new houses. Even, you could say, for front gardens. Well, placemaking itself, you can look it up in Wikipedia, placemaking is a sociological concept. It's not about architecture. But as an architect, you somehow have to deal with it on very different levels. Now, it has to do with how you interact with people who you are designing the houses for. Placemaking has also obvious to do with how you make a place. We don't have natural stone that much, but in every brick you can see the size of the hand of the bricklayer. We bake it, it's not just dried earth, but and the stones are smaller. I think there are lots of level that as an architect you have to do with this idea of placemaking, levels that are not necessarily interconnected. So I thought I want to show you two projects to see how these levels get in our work. Those are the two projects that I want to show, and they're both rather big in a very small town, so that's not the most easy thing. The town is the town of Gorkum. I'm sorry, it's a very difficult word to pronounce for other language. Gorkum. And it is on the water, and it is a military town. You can see how it looks now. You can see where the two projects are. On the left, you see Den Haan, which has 24 houses and 60 apartments and a huge number of 200 parking places because of, the second project is this 7 Bastion, 4 houses only, 25 very difficult apartments and 80 or 81 parking places. Here you see a map of Gorkum, and of course you see it is a military thing. You have these defenses to shoot from, I don't know the English word, well, you have bulwarks and in between. But before that, there also was, of course, because it has a very military position, Gorkum already had walls around it. And in the bottom left here, let me see. I have to push this. No, yes, here. Here something happens that is, let me see. Yeah, that is this. So this is a painting or a drawing from the first walls that were there. And I think it hangs in the Gorinchem Museum. I think it's a painting or a drawing that you can look at very long, because you see all things about how people live, how they trade, how they grow their vegetables. Anyway, at some point, these two, this old, what here you have this, like one, like two, like three, you see there's also differences in sizes of a urban block. If you see how big it is and how big it is here, then you see that's also modern times. There's scale differences, but they also, these scale differences exist on a completely different level there. So you have the big scale that you see here also of the water, the windmills and the walls, and the small scale of the roofs and the door and the people who are living right below. So this is, until today, you see that often in this little town. There are a lot of streets that you cannot look out because they end in one of the walls. So, having said that, I will go to this first project, Den Haan. This is what it looked like when we started. There had been a factory and it had been removed. This is what you see. Well, what do you see? To the right, it's a monument by law because it is part of this big bulwarks. So you have these different levels, and then you have this low city. Actually, it was a big parking place and it was nothing else. There was no connection on no level wherever with the city. So here you see a scheme. This is actually the parking garage for 200 cars going in here and out here, parking also here on the outside. And then you have the higher buildings here, and we make connections, and I will talk about two connections here, with the city to connect this place. Also, you can see that on the section, somehow, what you always have, you go up here, so this is the reason that you can never look out of this city, you always have to climb to look out. And this is the future higher dike level because of the climate changes. So we are, right now we are here, but we are already designing with this and this line. Okay. But so this same action, what happens here, we put it here so that we can put a parking garage and a public pedestrian area next to the pedestrian area that is already there. Oh, what do I do? I want to show something about this thing at Leeuwenhofje. So there was this existing Leeuwenhofje, Lionshofje. And this were actually... not so good houses, very cheap houses. And they had this strange thing that when you have the house on the right side, you have the garden here. And this is the street, a dead-end street. And you have, you always give your neighbors the right to pass your property. Because this is the property of this house, and this is the property of this house. So it has something to do with how this city has grown. And now, so I call this an urban monument. Well, that does not exist at all, and there's no protection for it. But this is what it looks like from the back. And you can understand our client wanted to demolish it because he thought he wouldn't sell his houses if those poor people that used to watch the football outside on their street together with a lot of noise, they would deflate the value of the house. But we kind of mirrored it with an also dead-end street, with also, but then our new houses here, and this is public street, also dead-end, but they have their little sheds and a little garden at that side too. So by doing this, we kind of saved the lions den, which goes in here, and we go in here, and the two keep each other alive. Another thing is that I wanted to stay below the trees. Before us, there was a plan of Ralph Erskine, and he had very high buildings, and I didn't want. Now, here you see the pedestrian footpath along the older footpath, with in between, you see a little green where you also have the water when it rains hard, and where you have frogs and those little animals. I forgot the English word. So this is the ventilation of the parking garage. And you can see it looks like different houses, but they are not different houses. They are, in fact, one big building. You see here a section again. So you have the ground floor where you access, and you access the elevator and the stairway if you go by car or by bike. But if you are from the pedestrian level, you will find front doors. So I think it's always important to connect front doors with where the pedestrian level is. Of course, you have different apartments. You have three apartments on every floor, and then you have bigger and more expensive apartments on the top. So they have bigger balconies and terraces. I think that works. This is what it looks like in one of the streets. So it's not all what it seems, because this house is part of this apartment. But we wanted to go to have those four houses to really connect with the apartments. And we wanted to connect to this street. This street always ended here. And now you can walk from the church up to the wall. And then you have to, of course, have this stairs, like you have. Of course, it's a street where not much car traffic is. This is what it looks like. The other project was the 7th Bastion. And you can see there was a hospital there. This is what it looks now. It's on the 7th Bastion, which had not been had any buildings until this came. Well, it was a hospital. And it's also the program for the apartments. The apartments are actually apartments that you can stay if one of the two is ill. So if you need a nursing home, usually you break up as a couple. One goes to the nursing home and the other stays in a home and goes visit. But you can stay here. It was a hospital, and it was not very beautiful, but what you saw from your bed was very beautiful, because you can look here all day to the birds and the water, the tides coming in and down. The people that are going to live here were never happy that they should move to this kind of hospital, of course, because all these people know one of them has a disease. We did a lot of studies for urban connections, and we did also a lot of studies for architectural connections, which in fact, Gorinchem is an older city, much older than like Amsterdam, and so it has different types of building, different ways of building. The scale is smaller. And we tried to somehow add that in the new projects, both by the relations and opening and connecting it. Here you see the model of the final design. So we wanted to have four houses on the market, which are not part of the hospital apartments. And then you see how the cars go in, chip, chip, they go in, and then blah, 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 go out. There's a parking garage underneath everything. We wanted a tower to end this, and we wanted an open court, although hospitals like covered courts, and we wanted to have connections with views to the water. Here it is when the scaffoldings went down. People had to wait long because it was a very complicated process, so it took 16 years, which is rather long for some people. But in the end, from this, we came to that. So people were really very happy, also the people in the neighborhood, to get rid of this building and have this right now. So here you see the balconies, which are balconies that can be accessed by a bed. So if you're in the bed, in your living room, you can chuk, roll on to the balconies because they're 3 meters deep, which is in an architectural sense very difficult. Here you see opening to the lower level of the city, the view. We paid a lot of attention to the concrete because we wanted it to really fit in, because the balconies, partly concrete and partly the steel, are meant to be one. Well, I think the pictures speak for themselves. The court is used by the people who live there a lot of times, and even if it's a very windy day, it covers, but you can still see out. Now, there's one more thing that I want to say. It will only take a minute, but I hope you will really take this with you. It's about green. I think we are not the only ones who live in cities, and I think we need to become aware about birds and bats and butterflies and the green they need. And it is a very simple thing to add details and things in your building. No big deal, actually. You just have to think of it when you write down your building descriptions, and it has really important results for the woonomgeving, for how you live there. This Brandevoort, which is a small town design from a master plan from Rob Krier, you can find that easily published, and I think we are building there too. But I think these green surroundings are very important for the people to have a very nice green area just around your home. Same goes for water in the city. Green is a part of a successful woonomgeving. Thank you.